Welcome to Professionalism and Customer Service in the Healthcare Environment, Conflict Resolution. This is Lecture B, Managing Conflict. The objectives for this lecture are to describe various styles for handling conflict and identify ways to minimize dysfunctional conflict in a group. The Thomas Kilman Conflict Mode Instrument, TKI, describes five conflict handling modes that can assist in responding to or coping with conflict situations and can also be viewed as traits that individuals habitually use to confront and deal with conflict situations. The five conflict handling modes fall under two broad dimensions. The first dimension, assertiveness, is when an individual seeks to satisfy his or her own concerns. The second, cooperativeness, is when an individual seeks to satisfy others' concerns. Thomas and Kilman's five conflict handling classifications are as follows. Competition, or a competing style for handling conflicts, is assertive and uncooperative. Avoidance is unassertive and uncooperative. Compromise represents the middle ground. Accommodation is unassertive and cooperative. And finally, collaboration is both assertive and cooperative. On the next few slides, we look at what each of these conflict handling classifications means. Again, assertiveness indicates that an individual is seeking to attain his or her own concerns. Cooperativeness indicates that an individual is looking to satisfy the concerns of others. The figure on this slide, representing Thomas and Kilman's conflict handling styles, illustrates the five classifications where they fall within the dimensions of assertiveness on the vertical axis and cooperativeness on the horizontal axis. In the upper left corner of the figure, we see competing. This style combines assertive and uncooperative behaviors. It signifies a win-lose response to conflict. An individual employing this style of conflict handling seeks to achieve his or her objective at all costs. According to Rahim, such a style disregards any needs, concerns, or desires of the other party. The competing style is suitable for conflicts that are insignificant or for urgent situations that require fast and decisive action. It is also useful for executing upper management's policies and strategies. In a clinical setting, physicians are quite used to being the leaders, and there may be differences between their views and those of the IT staff or between different clinicians. Therefore, this type of conflict handling can and will happen with certain individuals. To level the playing field for these situations, it's very important when implementing clinical systems to appoint a physician champion and to involve him or her in decision-making processes. Moving to the upper right side of the figure, we find the collaborating style. This style embodies assertive and cooperative behaviors. It signifies a win-win approach to a conflict. Participants seek to address the concerns of all parties, behave cooperatively, and try to achieve a favorable result for all involved. The focus of this style is not on accommodating the needs and expectations of all parties, but on illuminating differences to help solve problems and achieve the goals of all involved. To be effective, healthcare delivery requires the input of many departments and areas. Health IT, at its best, seeks the solution that optimizes the delivery process as a whole, while also addressing departmental concerns. You can be assured that collaboration, though not always easy, is a vital part of health IT implementation. It takes longer to accomplish and demands more blood, sweat, and tears, but collaboration is at the core of effective use of health IT. In the bottom left corner, we find the avoiding style. This style combines both unassertive and uncooperative modes. The party or individual may be aware of a conflict, but chooses to overlook it and to avoid others who may be a party to it. This conduct is also called passive-aggressive behavior. You may encounter people who seek to avoid change by ignoring your request for their assistance. You should be prepared to go up the chain of command to department heads and executives when needed to get the input of a person practicing avoidance. Right in the middle is the compromising style. This style is a middle ground conflict resolution behavior. The compromising approach results in neither a win-win nor a lose-lose situation. Both sides in this approach give up something to accept a result that is less than completely satisfying. Compromise will often be practiced in health IT. Many times, vendor solutions will accomplish most but not all of the needed functions. It's important to remember that many of the systems we implement are works in progress and are never fully complete, but are always being updated and refined. Compromise, therefore, is needed to move forward progressively and realize the benefits that a good but not totally perfect solution can provide. Finally, you can find the accommodating style in the bottom right corner. This style represents a combination of unassertive and cooperative behaviors. This approach is apparent when a party to a conflict places a rival party's interests above its own. This conciliatory style may be employed by a weaker party or by a party intent on maintaining a positive, long-term relationship with another. In part, because the relationship with clinical clients is so important for effective health IT implementation, accommodation will be required of the health IT professional. It's not uncommon to get pages late at night during implementations, requests to work on holidays, and requirements to work much longer than the standard 40 hours a week. When you demonstrate that you're accommodating to clinical staff, they'll be much more willing to assist with the changes you need from them. Thomas and Kilman's conflict handling styles provide a menu from which appropriate behaviors can be chosen based on a given circumstance. For example, the collaborative, that is, assertive and cooperative, approach to dealing with conflict is generally advocated as it results in a win-win that allows both sides to reach a most favorable outcome. However, the competitive approach, assertive, uncooperative, can be appropriate for conflict situations that are inconsequential or in need of quick, decisive action. Alternatively, an accommodating style that's unassertive and cooperative can be appropriate when a party seeks to continue and enhance a positive long-term relationship with another. The way an individual responds to a particular conflict can change and evolve over time. Interestingly, research reveals that individuals have certain innate preferences for handling conflict and that these correspond to Thomas and Kilman's conflict handling styles. Sternberg and Soriano suggest that it may be more fitting to think of the five conflict handling styles as relatively enduring conflict response traits or preferences as opposed to alternative choice behaviors people can choose to best match a particular conflict. In other words, when faced with a conflict, some people will prefer to win. Others will be obliging. Others will want to ignore the conflict. Others will choose to lose a little if they win some. And yet others will seek to come up with the most favorable result for all. It's important to remember that not all conflicts are the same in terms of their intensity. The power differential between the individuals experiencing the conflict plays directly into the intensity and challenge associated with confronting and managing the conflict. What happens when the conflict is with someone you don't report to directly, but who can influence your job or career? Robbins and Judge present a conflict intensity continuum that ranges from no conflict at one extreme to overt efforts to destroy an adversary at the other. The latter approach might appeal to you at various moments in your health IT career, but obviously it is not a productive path forward. Health IT implementations inevitably involve change, often major changes in individuals' daily work. Different people respond in different ways to the stress and challenges of change. Some people may try to undermine those they hold responsible for or who are involved in implementing the change. For instance, one nurse in a group you are about to instruct on a new EHR system might smile brightly and announce to the group, "Oh, here's the geek who's taking away our pens and paper and making our documentation process difficult." Stress can increase the likelihood of conflict. A thick skin and professional demeanor are the best defenses against conflict in such situations. In your job as a health IT professional, you may receive threats and ultimatums. For example, one health IT systems vendor, and he's probably not the only one, encountered a very impatient physician who was the head of the emergency department. The physician wanted the vendor to customize some functionality in an emergency department system. When told that the vendor required time to develop and test the solutions, the physician asked the vendor, "Do you like your job?" In this case, the vendor respectfully replied that he liked his job and that he wanted very much to provide the solution the physician asked for. But he held his ground that time was needed to ensure the customization would work to the physician's satisfaction. Unfortunately, assertive verbal attacks, rather than calm, constructive conversations, are more likely to occur in conflict situations. Retaliation isn't an effective way to deal with such attacks, because it only escalates unproductive conflict. Instead, stay with the rational and reasonable high ground. Conflict sometimes occurs in the form of overt questioning. When this happens to you, it's important that your answers are factually accurate and that you don't speculate. If you don't know the answer, write down the question and tell the person asking that you'll do some research and follow up with the answer later. Minor disagreements and misunderstandings comprise an estimated 30 to 40% of your working hours in health IT. Whereas conflicts at the upper end of the continuum tend to be uniformly negative or dysfunctional, conflicts occupying the lower levels of the continuum are generally positive or functional. Absence of conflict may sound ideal, but be sure that it's an indication the conflict has been resolved in a way that doesn't disregard the needs, concerns, or desires of any parties. Certain words and phrases can escalate conflict, and others can help de-escalate conflict. Words that show empathy and a willingness to help can reduce tension. Words that try to deflect blame, that imply a lack of willingness to assist, or are accusatory, can fuel conflict. Positive or functional conflict is productive in that it can lead to better decision-making, improved creativity and innovation, and an environment where group members feel engaged and willing to evaluate themselves critically. In health IT, conflict is inevitable. Implementations of new systems always involve a level of change, and working through conflict can often result in the refinements that make ideas about processes and systems more effective. Positive conflict encourages all viewpoints, including those of the minority, to be considered and incorporated into key decisions. Groupthink occurs when a group conforms to a point of view or idea without considering viable alternatives. As the researcher Janice argues, groupthink is a, quote, phenomenon that occurs when a team shuts down conflicting ideas or alternative points of view. In other words, the team begins to think alike and discounts perspectives that are at odds with that thinking, end quote. Positive or functional conflict can reduce groupthink. According to Robbins and Judge, positive conflict, quote, is an antidote for groupthink. It doesn't allow the group to passively rubber-stamp decisions that may be based on weak assumptions, inadequate consideration of relevant alternatives, or other debilities. Conflict challenges that status quo and therefore furthers the creation of new ideas, promotes reassessment of group goals and activities, and increases the probability that the group will respond to change. End quote. Read the quote on the slide from Robbins and Judge. As you can see, whereas positive conflict can lead to improved group decision-making and functioning, negative conflict can lead to impaired group decision-making. Negative conflict can also inhibit communication and discussion, reduce cohesiveness, and result in negative, dysfunctional infighting and arguing among members. If intense enough, it can destroy a group. A college in Maryland created a curriculum to teach conflict management skills as part of the nursing leadership program. This effort was in direct response to the increased prevalence of new graduate nurses being ill-prepared to handle negative conflict with their coworkers and consequently leaving their first jobs. In order to stimulate positive or productive conflict, it's necessary to have some level of dissent that forces people to examine their assumptions and beliefs critically and to fully consider appropriate options. Techniques for encouraging this interaction include rewarding dissent, creating groups with greater diversity and heterogeneity, and including a devil's advocate. A devil's advocate takes a position at odds with the one proposed and agreed upon by a group. In doing so, the devil's advocate attempts to bring others into an argumentative discourse in order to test the strengths of the original positions, possibly identifying weaknesses in its assumptions, and moving the group to a better and more fully reasoned position. The first step is to check that there really is disagreement on an issue and not just a misunderstanding. Human communication is an imperfect process. One person might have simply misconstrued what another person said. Encouraging open discussion of differences can also give individuals the chance to exchange views. Focusing on overarching interests can also keep people from getting mired in the details of the particular issue. If an issue is multifaceted, another strategy is to ask individuals to identify which elements are the most important to them. Having group members identify shared interests can also be a way to reduce divisiveness. This concludes conflict resolution. In summary, conflict can be both a positive and negative force. Constructive conflict can lead to innovation and prevent groupthink, whereas negative conflict can impede team performance. Individuals respond to conflict in different ways. It's helpful to recognize your own conflict handling style, as well as that of others. Managing conflict appropriately can minimize dysfunctional conflict and foster effective team performance.